been 11 years ever since the 26/11 attack in Mumbai. What has this government done different to change the security narrative? What have been the loopholes in the past? And also, what is the current scenario?
2008, there's enough evidence to suggest that this was an operation by the Pakistan deep state. Planned by the military but executed by civilians.
The challenge for India is that Mumbai 2008 is a good example where the efficacy of the non-state, which is the Lashkar or whatever these groups are actually being supported in a very, very deep and robust manner.
Now, whether it is Lashkar or whether it is Jaish-e-Mohammed, they're all being sponsored by ISI.
We've not been able to take out the center of gravity of any one of the entities that have been hurting us for the last many, many decades. Whether it is Hafiz Sayed, whether it is Maulana Masood Azhar, whether it is Zaki Urman Lakhvi. So that's the proof of the pudding in your ability to take the battle to the enemy.
Hello and welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, it's been 11 years ever since the 26/11 attack in Mumbai. What has this government done different to change the security narrative? What have been the loopholes in the past? And also, what is the current scenario? To weigh in on the security perspective, I have joining me on the roundtable, there is Lieutenant General Sanjay Kulkarni. He's a former DG Infantry and he was also part of the platoon. He led the platoon that recaptured Siachen in 1984. We have, of course, Commodore Uday Bhaskar, old familiar face, strategy, security expert, columnist. We all know him on Roundtable. Good to have you back, Commodore. And Air Vice Marshal Arjun Subramaniam. He is a fighter pilot. He's a military historian and a strategic commentator. Joining me also is an old friend and journalist and author, Sandeep Unnithan. In fact, congratulations, Sandeep. You are out with your latest book, Operation X. This talks about the untold story of India's covert naval war in East Pakistan in 71. And there is an old book of his that is now back in the news, Black Tornado. This is actually about 26/11, is also now being made into a web series. So do watch out for that. Sandeep, can you put the conversation into perspective? Given the fact it's been 11 years, given the fact that you've written about two covert operations, where are we placed now? A little bit of history and perspective.
Sure, Priya. Thank you very much. It's been it's an honor to be on the round table with you, Priya.
And first, tell us about the books.
Yes. And the books, were basically, the first one came out 5 years back, as you said, Black Tornado. It's about Pakistan's covert attack on India in November 2008. There's enough evidence to suggest that this was an operation by the Pakistan deep state. Planned by the military but executed by civilians, the jihadi groups that the Pakistan Army shelters. This book actually talks about the response of the Indian security forces to this attack, to this very dastardly attack, one of the first of its kinds, multi-stage, multi-site attack in one city. Which was inspired.
It's a hybrid attack, you
know. That's correct. It's a hybrid attack. It's inspired from many other attacks that were carried out in other countries, and especially in Israel. And also there was a plot that was foiled in the United States after 9/11 called the Landmarks Plot. So we have reason to believe that 26/11 was nothing but a copy-paste of the Landmarks Plot that was foiled in the United States. And the other book, of course, is the one that I wrote recently, is Operation X. It's probably the only time that India has resorted to covert war on a very large scale. Mm-hmm. In the last 70 years plus, there's only one instance of India resorting to covert war on a very large scale, which was the training of the Mukti Bahini in 1971, in the run-up to the 1971 war. And the larger point being, these two books are interconnected, Priya, in the sense that 70 years plus of independence, both India and Pakistan have seen numerous wars, and all of these wars have a covert aspect to them. Like in 1947-48, you had the raiders, which was nothing but tribesmen that were launched by the Pakistan Army, in fact, led by them as well. Right. 65, you had Pakistan's special forces disguised as raiders again.
To give them deniability.
To give them deniability. 71 was the only instance of India using covert warfare. And of course, in 99, you had the Northern Light Infantry disguised as Mujahideen. And more recently, the attacks in Mumbai in 1993, 2006, and 2008 have been carried out by the Pakistan deep state. through its jihadi elements, that the Lashkar-e-Taiba and the Jaish-e-Mohammed, for instance. So in that sense, we're talking of a very long history of covert warfare on the Indian subcontinent, the Indian establishment versus the Pakistan deep state. And 2611 was one of those high points.
Since there are no politicians on the table, and I think you and I are the only ones who will talk about the political will, if the 2611 had happened, you know, just the political reaction to 2611 and say the reaction to Pathankot, to Fulwana, do you see a change in the tempo, the change in the reaction?
Yeah, certainly, Priya. I see a sea change in the way this government has handled terrorist attacks compared to previous governments. And by previous governments, I'm also including the NDA-1 of Prime Minister Vajpayee and Prime Minister Manmohan Singh's UPA-1 and UPA-2. Mm-hmm. Where there was an attempt to engage Pakistan, and the fact that the military option seemed to be off the table in those years. You know, of course, there was Operation Parakram, but you know, these were deterred. The military response was deterred, and I want to quote what Commodore Uday Bhaskar is. This acronym that he has coined called nuclear weapons enabled terrorism. So effectively, we've been seeing nuclear weapons enabled terrorism on the subcontinent for the last 3 decades. And
which means Pakistan, they use the nuclear threat of a nuclear weapon to carry out whatever they want to.
That's correct. So they use the nuclear weapons as a shield to continue using the sword of the non-state actors, the terrorist groups, to continue to bleed India. And the attempt on the Pakistan deep state's part is to convince our political establishment that the nuclear escalation ladder is very short, that if India resorts to the military option, then there is going to be a nuclear exchange. Whereas this government seems to understand the fact that the nuclear escalation ladder is actually very, very, very long. I mean, it's not so short, it's 25 steps or more. And they believe there is space for exercising that military option below the nuclear threshold. And this is, we've seen this in 2016 with the surgical strikes of in response to Uri, the Uri attack, and of course this year with the Balakot bombing of the terrorist camp in response to Pulwama.
So you're also, you're a military historian, so just help us put this in perspective also, the narrative now as what has been happening in the past.
Sandeep mentioned extensively about 1971. But what we need to understand is that we attempted significantly large-scale covert operations in 1984 also, between 1982 and 1984 in Sri Lanka.
Yes.
And the significant difference between 1971 and 1984 was this word synergy. In 1971, there was synergy between all instruments of statecraft that allowed covert operations to be successful. In 1984, I'm afraid that synergy was missing, and therefore covert operations did not succeed in Sri Lanka. And if it had succeeded, actually, probably we would have seen the end of the LTT by 1987. And as a historian, I've seen that that it is synergy that leads to success of covert operations.
Well, you know, this conversation on covert versus overt, you know, if you could weigh in on this.
You know, I think since we are looking at this, Priya, in the context of the 11th anniversary of 2611, I thought one of the strands that we might want to focus on is the non-state entity, because that is the point that Sandeep was also drawing attention to. And for me as an analyst, you know, whether we look at this as the covert or the overt nature of the attack, the way in which force has been used in this case against India, I think our challenge and predicament is that what we often refer to as the proxy war, which begins in January 1990, really, if you want to put a date on it, where you find the Pakistani state, and as Sandeep had mentioned, they are using the nuclear weapon to enable terror, which is why, you know, those of us who were writing on the subject introduced this particular acronym, nuclear weapon enable terror. So what happens is that this overt, covert, and state, non-state gets leavened, or get, you know, it's overlapping in a very complex way. So today, I think the challenge for India is that Mumbai 2008 is a good example, where the efficacy of the non-state, which is the Lashkar or whatever these groups are actually being supported in a very, very deep and robust manner by the state entity. So the very fact, for instance, if you want to get into the tactical detail, the boat coming all the way from Karachi onto the reaches of Bombay, Mumbai now, and being able to land near that particular Budhwar Park and then make its way. So you find that it is the efficacy and the ruthlessness now of the non-state entity that has allowed 9/11 to happen, the 26/11 to happen. And for me, again, when you talk about the covert dimension, I keep saying, what is the responsibility of the Indian state? It is to prevent any kind of operation, whether it's a covert, overt, non-state, state entity, so that the citizen is safe. And my, you know, rather bleak assessment is that 11 years later, I don't think we have really learned the right lessons in terms of being able to implement various gaps as far as the system is concerned. Okay. And the last point I want to add is that the non-state entity, whatever name you give the non-state, Al-Qaeda, IS, Lashkar, whatever, they are not static. So it is very unlikely that you will have a repeat of 26/11. But if the Saudi experience is something to go by, the non-state entity, whether with state support or otherwise, is aware of the drone, for instance. So today you can use your technology to create the same kind of what I would call as, you know, the vulnerabilities can be exploited. And I'm not very sure that the Indian state has really been able to anticipate, because I've said this repeatedly on your show and elsewhere, it is not enough to create an NIA. We do not want post-facto expertise. We want the state to exude capacity and confidence that I can prevent, I can preempt, whether it's a 26/11 or it's another drone attack a la Saudi Arabia, but the citizen should feel secure.
Who we call as non-state actors, they're actually not non-state. They're sponsored by a state. You know, it's something like outsourcing. You may not want to do the housekeeping, so you outsource housekeeping. So that becomes a kind of a...
Nicely put.
So you look at it. Now, whether it is Lashkar or whether it is Jaish-e-Mohammed, they're all being sponsored by ISI with a purpose, because everywhere you can see same Qureshi, who was the Prime Minister during 26/11, is now the External Affairs Minister for Imran Khan. So the same man is there, right? Now you realize it, that it's so much better that there is some buffer. Now, instant, what did he say? That instant thing was, no, we did not do it. It's not the state of Pakistan that has done it. I think someone from within India has done it, or someone from Bangladesh has done it. So that's the way they're looking at it. So when David Hadley is sort of, you know, I would say interrogated, he then spilled the beans that, yes, some SIM cards were got from Bangladesh, or picked up from Calcutta, and somebody says he picked it up from Delhi. It's the army which is controlling the nation. It is the army which is thinking. It is the army which is propagating. And therefore, army ensures that the narrative is, you know, interpreted the way they are looking at it, slowly and steadily.
Quickly, you want to come in? Then
yeah.
I take away.
Priya, I was only wondering, taking off from General Kulkarni, the two things that I've always thought about when you talk about insulating a porous and a diverse country like India from terrorism, from non-state actors, from covert operations, from what is being increasingly known as hybrid war, is broadly called the hardening of Indian society. And I think, we've always said that we are a rather soft, we are a rather soft nation. And by hardening, I don't mean to say literally a physical hardening, but it is hardening a society so that it feels secure.
Even like Balakot.
I don't mean that. I mean to say disciplining yourself as citizens and as a group of people against perceived threats. That's something that a chaotic democracy like India is not really used to. And that is something that is an imperative in the years ahead if you want to insulate yourself or if you want to protect yourself. So, you know, I've always liked this word of a more disciplined democracy. Now, how you would like to interpret that can be depending on which side of the ideological spectrum you...
I was just going to say Prime Minister Modi has his own ideas on that one.
In this, I'm looking at it purely from a national security perspective. And I think as a citizenry, we need to be more disciplined.
On that note, we're going to take a break. But after the break, I'm going to ask my panel to discuss, is the theatre of action now shifted to, say, Punjab with the opening up of the Kartarpur corridor? So stay with us after a break. Hello and welcome back to the roundtable. We are here discussing, well, national security on the anniversary of 2611. Are we safer now than we were, say, 11 years ago? Sandeep, before the break, we are discussing covert versus overt. Is the opening up of this the Kartarpur corridor, are you worried that may lead to more covert action via Punjab?
Well, Priya, there's certainly a lot to worry about. The fact is that the Kartarpur corridor could well be a Trojan horse for the Pakistan deep state to infiltrate Punjab and, you know, rake up passions there. And we have none other than the Chief Minister of Punjab, Captain Amrinder Singh, repeatedly warning us over the last 3 years of the number of terrorist modules, Khalistani terrorist modules that have been uncovered. 26 was the count that he gave. The arms and ammunitions that have been infiltrated across the border. And there's every reason to suspect that to believe that the Pakistan deep state is executing what it once called the K2 strategy, which is Kashmir and Khalistan. This is what was spoken of in the late 80s and early 90s. So the K2 strategy is in full swing now, and not only do they see an opportunity in Kashmir, but they want to restart the operations, the covert operations in Punjab as well. So Kartarpur, you must welcome the spirit and the sentiment of the people, there's every reason to suspect that this could be, there's much more than meets the eye.
I'd like to add to that, may I? You know, I think what Sandeep has said is very important. First of all, to keep in mind the historical kind of recall of the K2 kind of formulation that Pakistan had evolved. It's actually late 80s. It is the Ziaul-Haq last phase when they are actually responding to the end of the Soviet occupation invasion in Afghanistan and the retooling of Pakistan's overall strategy, particularly in relation to India. So I'm glad that he's reminded us, and I would say the audience at large, about K2. It is there in the historical recall of Pakistan's strategy. Very often we talk about bleeding the enemy by 1,000 cuts. That is the overall frame. Within that, the K2, the Kashmir and the Khalistan focus is something that they tried. And of course, the Indian response, though it was a bit late, finally prevented any further kind of, shall we say, critical loss to the Indian state and the sovereignty of the state. But my own sort of, I would say, observation on this, Priya, is that as an analyst, one is constantly looking for patterns and what is the probability of a given exigency. Since you spoke about India and the covert threat, what is the current kind of manifestation likely to be? I would definitely flag Kartarpur, in as much as we all welcome the religious sentiment and the fact that finally this corridor, which has been going on for a long time, if you recall, going back to Mr. Vajpayee's time to where we are now, the fact that it is being realized is to be welcomed. But let us not forget that for Pakistan, even in October, when Prime Minister Imran Khan was doing the first formal inauguration, you had a Khalistani leader, Gopal Singh. He was there in the audience, the TV cameras had picked him up.
Right, yes.
As recently as yesterday or day before, I forget, last week, again we had an event from the Pakistani side where well-known names from the Khalistani movement were part of the so-called congregation, the audience. So again,
so it's more overt than covert.
It is this time, and I think thanks to cameras and technology, you can see the faces. So my only point as a security analyst is that for India, the probability that the Kartarpur corridor could be misused is reasonably high, which is why I come back to my earlier point. The state and its ability to preempt, that is what we need to really focus on, because God forbid if there is an accident, incident anywhere in the country, you know, which is a replay either of 2611 or of Pulwama or something that we have not yet been able to envision. I think those are the kind of capacities that the state, I fear, has not really invested in. Because it's not about intent of Prime Minister Modi. His heart may be in the right place. But the rest of the system has to implement. And I repeatedly say what we said in the Kargil Committee report 20 years ago in 1999. It's 2019 today. We have not really implemented, starting with the revamp of Indian intelligence. And that is where I keep saying that I, as an analyst, am not as convinced as one would like to be. And going back to Mumbai, my last point, I don't want to hog the timeline here, that we are talking about a maritime threat to India, 2611. Today, India's overall investment in the Navy is declining. It is now the naval chief, Admiral Karambir, went on record recently to say that we are now at 13-14%. You cannot deal with the challenges that India has. And I'm not just making a case for the Navy. It's for the overall grid. That's my point.
You know what? You look at 2611. We go back to 2611. All this post-Babri. You realize it. And Pakistan has realized they have not been actually been able to divide the Indian Muslims the way they thought they could. So that is a very big thing. So post-Babri Masjid, the failure has been seen by Pakistan, that the Indian Muslim doesn't seem to stand by them much, that they would want to take the leadership. Also, the Indian Muslim, that is not working out for Pakistan. So that's a very good thing that's happening. Where they have succeeded partly is in Kashmir. Now, looking at the Sikhs, despite what they did in 84, you found that it was the Sikhs who did away with the militancy in Punjab, and the Sikhs are 100% with you within India. So the Indian Sikh stands by India. So that's another very important thing. So the Indian Muslim stands by India. The Indian Sikhs stand by India. Now, where does Pakistan is now wanting to divide? Now, where it wants to divide is the Sikhs from Canada, Sikhs from UK, Sikhs from USA. That's where what he said, Chawla, he seemed to be sitting on the stage along with it. The kind of money that is flowing in from Canada, you see the kind of support that the Canadian Prime Minister is getting from the Sikhs to be able to be in power. So all this, what is working out, is indicative that Pakistan is yet not succeeding in breaking a society which it feels it can, but it is failing. And that is where we need to take a stand and make sure that we must remain united. We must take everybody along. It is very, very important. Sometimes you find that the Prime Minister making a statement which some people might say, aise hai, sabka saath, sabka vishwas, and So, sabka saath, sabka vishwas is very, very important. That is what will keep this country united. If it doesn't,
The discipline that he's looking for.
That fault lines you will allow the your neighbors to exploit. Okay. You must never give that to the neighbor.
Okay, three quick, you know, taking a cue from what both the gentlemen have mentioned. First, Commodore Uday Bhaskar. Now, there's been a fair amount of deterrent capability that has been built up after 2011. You look at weaponry with the special forces, you look at the NSG, you look at the C-130, you look at the improved synergy between the special forces and within all the elements of the national security establishment. I think there's been a significant improvement. But where I would tend to agree with him is that this should have logically been followed up with an enhanced ability to coerce, which I'm afraid hasn't kept pace with what we would have expected. For example, I'll just put a simple thing. We've had Osama bin Laden and the ISIS chief being knocked off. I mean, say we've not been able to take out the center of gravity of any one of the entities that have been hurting us for the last many, many decades. Whether it is Hafiz Sayed, whether it is Maulana Masood Azhar, whether it is Zaki Urman Lakhvi. So that's the proof of the pudding in your ability to take the battle to the enemy.
Right.
That is one.
Yeah.
The second is about the Indian Muslim that you mentioned. I think the Indian Muslim is the most homogeneous entity you can see anywhere. And if you recollect, sometime in the 1990s, when the Lashkar and the Jaish were feeling the heat from the Indian Army in J&K, there were attempts to prop up the Indian Mujahideen. Now, those attempts to prop up the Indian Mujahideen were not successful, because the Indian Mujahideen in the hinterland didn't get the kind of support from the people as they expected. Then the Al-Qaeda was not able to make adequate inroads into India. The ISIS has managed to get very few recruits from India as compared to a number of other countries. So on that front, when I talk about internal hardening and go along with your homogeneity of the Indian Muslim, I think it's a great strength that we need to look at in our counterterrorism capability. Okay. And the last thing that I want to talk again is about Punjab. Now, you know, I've spoken with people on the ground and they are genuinely concerned about what they call Operation 2020. And now Operation 2020 is a time frame that the Pakistani deep state has sort of set for itself in order to recommence the process of subversion in Punjab. And you look at it, it's a cyclical process. End of 1980s, terrorism in Punjab was being hit very badly because of KPS Gill and the others. And then the focus shifted to JNK. Now, JNK is on the, under control as far as terrorism is concerned. The focus has reshifted to Punjab. So there is Operation 2020, which is serious. And I'm also given to understand that there are covert attempts to cultivate elements from society to sort of reaffirm their commitment to the Khalistani movement in return for gratis various kind of issues, whether
which
it's
is what he flagged,
which is a Canadian citizenship or trips to Canada or the UK. It's very much in process, so it's part of a comprehensive strategy that is being put in place.
Okay, we're totally out of time, Sandy. Sandeep, I'll give you the last word, since one of the reasons we got together was your book. 2020, are you worried?
Yeah, Priya, well, it is a worrying prospect what is being planned across the border, because let's not forget that we're dealing with the Pakistan deep state, which does not have to be elected every 5 years.
Yes.
The Pakistan deep state selects a prime minister every 5 years. That's the difference between the two systems. Mm-hmm. And it's the only system in the world. It's the only army in the world that directly controls nuclear weapons. So that is, of course, very scary. But then I'm very confident of the kind of understanding now of this new threat that exists in the political establishment now. And the fact that we need to have a comprehensive national response to the threats of this nature, that is a bit reassuring. Though I would like to also flag these points that my co-panelists made on the fact that we haven't really moved forward on creating the kind of structures post the Kargil war that would actually prioritize acquisitions and building up of capabilities that would coerce Pakistan. Mm-hmm. This is the point that A. Marshall Subramaniam made on the coercive aspect of the Indian state. So we actually have a long way to go in all of this, but happily we seem to have made a beginning of sorts.
Priya, give me 10 seconds. I can't help adding that the Pakistani deep state, as I see it today, not only do they decide on prime ministers, I think they are also now trying to demonstrate that they can decide whether the Pakistani army chief can get an extension or not. But that's a subject for another discussion.
Okay. So I was going to say, we're going to end on a note of caution. Yes, are we better off than we were 11 years ago? I think most of us would say yes. Including you?
Yes.
Okay. But at the end of the day, I think note of caution is the right note to end on, especially when we're dealing with our neighbor. But that's it for now. And once again, congratulations on your books, and we are waiting for the next one. But thank you for watching this show. We'll see you again same time next week.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.